Sometimes, people are born with amazing abilities for whatever reason, and they're known as gifted people. But sometimes, ordinary people can gain superhuman abilities when things happen to them or something is discovered that relates to those experiences. Ready to join the Americano team? Then make sure to subscribe with notifications on so you don't miss any of our interesting videos ever again. That being said, let's begin! Christina, the Astonishing. This woman had the power of indestructibility, and though she's not an officially canonized saint in the church, she was considered a saint in her own lifetime, and has some pretty interesting stories nonetheless, all of which display the fact that she was basically indestructible. She lived in the late 12th century and early 13th century, right around the time the church was forming the modern canonization process, and she's never been formally canonized. Nonetheless, she was popularly considered a saint for centuries after her death. Her relics have been preserved, she was included in a version of Butler's Lives of Saints, and was even honored on local liturgical calendars at various points. Born in 1150 in a small town in present-day Belgium, Christina was orphaned as a teenager and worked as a shepherdess. Then, sometime in her early 20s, she suffered from a massive seizure. When the episode passed, she was lying on the ground completely limp. Unable to see breathing or hear a heartbeat, those with her pronounced her dead. Soon after, a funeral was held at her local parish. In the middle of the funeral service, she suddenly woke up. Full of energy, she stood right up like nothing had happened. When she realized she was surrounded by a large group of people, she started levitating and flew up to the roof. This wouldn't be the only time that she levitates. She levitated often because she couldn't bear the spiritually stinky smell of sinful people, it was claimed. When she finally stopped levitating at the funeral, she explained that she had, in fact, died. After her soul separated from her body, she was given a glimpse of the horrors of purgatory. God then gave her a choice: either remain dead and go to heaven, or return to earth and do penance for those in purgatory. Moved to zeal at the sight of those suffering in purgatory, she chose the latter. The next moment, she came back to life. She voluntarily lived in extreme poverty, wearing only rags and living without a home. She avoided human contact as much as possible, but deprivation wasn't enough. She also sought out suffering to increase her penance. People watched her intentionally throw herself into fires and remain there for extended periods of time. She would appear to be suffering greatly with terrible shrieking, but then would exit the fire completely unscathed. She allowed herself to be attacked by dogs and would intentionally run her body through thickets of thorn bushes. And in winter, she would immerse herself in a nearby river and remain in the nearly freezing water for hours or even days on end. As if this wasn't extreme enough, she would apparently even allow herself to be sucked into water wheels of nearby mills getting spun around. Again, as painful and harmful as these things seemed to be for her, she would always emerge seemingly unharmed. Jason Padgett. In 2002, two men savagely attacked Jason Padgett outside a karaoke bar, leaving him with a severe concussion and post-traumatic stress disorder. But the incident also turned Padgett into a mathematical genius who sees the world through the lens of geometry. Padgett, a furniture salesman from Tacoma, Washington, who had very little interest in academics, developed the ability to visualize complex mathematical objects and physics concepts intuitively. The injury, while devastating, seems to have unlocked the part of his brain that makes everything in his world appear to have a mathematical structure. Padgett says that he now sees shapes and angles everywhere in real life, from the geometry of a rainbow to the fractals in water spiraling down a drain. Padgett is one of a rare set of individuals with acquired savant syndrome, in which a normal person develops prodigious abilities after a severe injury or disease. Other people have developed remarkable musical or artistic abilities, but few people have acquired mathematical faculties like Padgett's. Before the injury, Padgett was a self-described jock and partier. He hadn't progressed beyond the pre-algebra in his math studies. He said that he cheated on everything and never even cracked open a book. But all that would change the night of his attack. Padgett recalls being knocked out for a split second and seeing a bright flash of light. Two guys started beating him, kicking him in the head as he tried to fight back. Later that night, Doctors diagnosed Paget with a severe concussion and a bleeding kidney and sent him home with pain medications. Soon after the attack, Paget suffered from PTSD and debilitating social anxiety, but at the same time, he noticed that everything looked different. He describes his vision as discrete picture frames with a line connecting them, but still at real speed. If you think of vision as the brain taking pictures all the time and smoothing them into a video, it's as though Paget sees the frames without the smoothing. He also says that everything seems to have a pixelated look. With Paget's new vision came an astounding mathematical drawing ability. He started sketching circles made of overlapping triangles, which helped him understand the concept of pi, the ratio of a circle's circumference to its diameter. "There's no such thing as a perfect circle," he said, which he knows because he can always see the edges of a polygon that approximates the circle. Tony Sicoria. Tony was a 42-year-old man, very fit and robust, a former college football player who had become a well-regarded orthopedic surgeon in a small city in upstate New York. One afternoon in 1994, he was at a lakeside pavilion for a family gathering. It was pleasant and breezy, but he noticed a few storm clouds in the distance. It looked like rain. He went to a payphone outside the pavilion to make a quick call to his mother, and obviously because this was before the age of cell phones, he said that he was talking to his mother, there was a little bit of rain, thunder in the distance, and then his mother hung up. The phone was a foot away from where he was standing when he was struck by lightning. He says that he remembers a flash and then was flying backwards as he was hit right in the face by the bolt of electricity. Bewildered, he said he looked around and said to himself, "Oh shoot. I'm dead." He saw people converging on his body. He claims he saw people trying to help him and someone was giving him CPR and then BAM! He was suddenly back among the living. Sicoria knew that he was back in his own body because he felt pain. Pain from the burns on his face and on his left foot where the electrical charge had entered and exited. And then he realized only bodies have pain. He wanted to go back. He wanted to tell the woman to stop giving him CPR, to let him go, but it was too late. After a minute or two, when he could speak, he said, "It's okay, I'm a doctor." The woman, who turned out to be an intensive care unit nurse, replied, "A few minutes ago, you weren't." He continued to recover over the next several weeks. Sicoria also consulted a neurologist because he was feeling sluggish, which was unusual for him, and he was having some difficulties with his memory. He found himself forgetting the names of people he knew well. He had a thorough neurological exam, an EEG, and an MRI. Again, nothing seemed amiss. A couple of weeks later, when his energy returned, Sicoria went back to work. There were still some lingering memory problems, and he occasionally forgot the names of rare diseases or surgical procedures. However, his surgical skills were unimpaired. In another 2 weeks, his memory problems disappeared, and that, he thought, was the end of the matter. What happened next fills Sicoria with amazement even now, a dozen years later. Life had returned to normal, seemingly, when, quote, suddenly, over 2 or 3 days, there was this insatiable desire to listen to piano music. This was completely out of keeping with anything in his past. He had a few piano lessons as a boy, he said, but no real interest. He didn't have a piano in his house. What music he did listen to tended to be rock and roll. Despite not really knowing how to play the piano and not knowing how to read or write music, Sicoria got himself a piano and promptly began to play everything he heard in his head. He'd even wake up at 4 in the morning and play until he had to go do his orthopedic surgery. Ken Walters. Before becoming a superhuman, Ken Walters was an engineer. In 1986, he had an accident. He was 30 years old and working on a farm when an out-of-control forklift crushed him against a wall. He suffered horrific injuries, including spine fractures. That accident not only took his capability to walk again, he also suffered financially because of the accident. The stress of these events ended in another 2 strokes as well. It's believed that the second stroke that he had in 2005 transformed him from mere mortal into a superhuman. After the attack, Ken found a compulsion to start scribbling away on the writing pad that he had in the hospital for communicating with other people. This is despite never having any interest in drawing or doodling before. His doctor explained to him that sometimes after a stroke, due to the brain rewiring paths, new skills and talents can be uncovered. There was a warning though. Often, these conditions were temporary. When he came back to home from the hospital, he began making digital artwork on his computer. His artwork was amazing, and he became a very popular artist. But Walter's biggest break came when video game maker Electronic Arts saw his gallery. They hired Walters to draw some monsters, and now his stuff appears in the world-building video game, Spore. Even today, reputed companies purchase his artwork for their offices. Ken Walters is a professional artist selling his artwork via the internet. Life still is not easy for Ken. He still struggles with his health and is physically disabled. He suffers from CFS and has hearing problems. Despite so much going against him, he continues to create art. His work is featured in 5 virtual worlds and in a number of art galleries. Tommy McHugh. 10 days after having a subarachnoid hemorrhage, which is a stroke caused by bleeding in and around the brain, Tommy McHugh, an ex-con who had been in his fair share of trouble, became a new man, with a personality that nobody recognized. When he was a young man, Tommy did time in prison, but after his stroke at age 51, everything changed. Suddenly, his head was full of rhymes and pictures, and he became obsessed with the sudden urge to write poetry, paint, and draw. And so he began to do all of this for up to 19 hours a day. Desperate to find out what was going on, Tommy wrote to several neuroscientists and ended up working closely with Alice Flaherty at Harvard Medical School and Mark Lithgow at University College London. Scanning Tommy's brain was impossible after an operation to treat the stroke damage left him with a piece of metal in his head. Instead, Lithgow performed a neuropsychological evaluation. Tommy's IQ was in the normal range. However, he showed verbal disinhibition. He tended to talk a lot, and had difficulty with tests that required him to switch between different cognitive tasks, all of which suggested problems with the frontal lobes. The frontal lobes play a vital role in abstract thought and creativity. They're constantly bombarded with raw sensory data from the world around us, most of which is deemed irrelevant by the brain and screened from conscious awareness. Blocking this inhibition using magnetic pulses can make people more creative, even unleashing savant-like skills. Before he died in September 2012, he was painting 3 to 9 pictures at a time. Franco Magnani. Franco Magnani is known by many as the memory artist, due to his amazing ability to create beautiful works of art that are true to life, but based on nothing but his own memories. He began his working life as a furniture maker, designing pieces out of wood. He grew up in Pontito, Italy, but ended up moving to the Italian Riviera to become a cook, eventually working aboard cruise ships that toured through the Caribbean, enjoying traveling the world and taking in as much of it as he could. He eventually moved to California, where he became very sick and was in danger of his health seriously failing him. His doctor decided that what he needed was extended rest and relaxation, hoping that this would allow his body to recover from whatever malady he was suffering from. This seems to be the event that triggered his superhuman abilities, which, in his case, resulted in him becoming a fantastic artist who was able to paint incredible scenes that were true to life, despite only conjuring them up from memory. During his period of rest, he said that he had increasingly vivid dreams of his hometown of Pontito, which seemed as real as if he was actually there in person, which, of course, wasn't the case. He hadn't been back home for years, and was surprised that these visions kept persisting and in such incredible detail. As these visions became more prevalent, he began feeling the urge to actually paint these scenes. Despite having no formal training at all, he sat down and ended up producing hundreds of miraculously detailed paintings of the Pontito that he knew as a child. These scenes even came to him in 3D, being so intense that he could turn his head, for example, to see around corners or from different angles, which is simply amazing. What was even more amazing was that he soon found that these paintings were so true to real life that they may as well be painted directly from photographs, even after all his time away. His works of art earned him worldwide fame, and it's nuts to think that he was able to recall his childhood home so clearly after so long, simply because he got sick. It's also odd that he's such a gifted artist, and he says he was never so talented before his sickness, meaning that his illness not only turned him into a walking camera, able to recall the most minute details of Pontito, but also a world-famous artist, capable of painting breathtaking landscapes. Stephen Wiltshire. Not quite an acquired savant, Wiltshire's story is still quite impressive, and we just had to feature him on our list. He was diagnosed with autism at a young age, and for quite some time in his early life was unable to speak, being entirely mute. His autism diagnosis came at the age of 3, and those around him soon noticed that he loved to draw. Much like Magnani, he's able to produce stunningly realistic drawings, but unlike Magnani, his ability isn't limited to recreating scenes only from his childhood home. He began by drawing animals, but has since moved on and is now able to paint cityscapes that have such incredible detail that they may as well be actual photographs. His first word was paper, which we think is quite fitting, given his penchant for drawing, and it seems that he put everything he had into his artwork. He is incredibly talented, but his real superpower comes from being able to take the most cursory glance at a scene and then be able to masterfully reconstruct the entire thing entirely from memory and needing no further input to be able to do so. He has an encyclopedic knowledge of anything that interests him, including American cars, about which he knows just about everything that's possible to know. He became a sensation at the age of 7 when his superpowers came to light, and is now a world-renowned artist who has done amazingly well for himself, despite his autism, which some might think would hold him back. Wiltshire, however, hasn't let anything stop him at all, and many say that his autism could be the driving force behind his amazing talent. Steven considers to amaze art critics all over the world, right up to this very day, and one amazing example saw him take a 20-minute helicopter ride in Hong Kong before heading to his studio and recreating it in vivid detail across a 10-meter-long canvas. He's been all over the world and has been able to recreate every city he's been to, and we think it's crazy that he can do so simply from memory, no matter how little time he spends studying them, which isn't long at all. Derek Amato. Our final acquired savant is a man who also suffered a massive brain injury that unlocked wonderful superpowers, morphing him from being a regular person to an absolute genius after what could easily have been a tragic accident. He had lost his job and was basically homeless, trying to land on his feet when the accident occurred. He ended up diving into a swimming pool to catch a football, but did so in the shallow end, leading to him smashing his head into the floor, causing extensive damage. He lost consciousness repeatedly afterward, convinced that he was a pro baseball player, which is usually a sign that someone's completely lost their mind. His concussion was severe, but he also lost 1/3 of the hearing ability in his right ear and suffered memory loss, as well as intense headaches. 4 days later, however, he realized that he had turned himself, much like Tony Sicoria, into a musical prodigy. While he was recovering, he stopped by a friend's house, spotted an electric piano, and despite never having played before, proceeded to sit down and begin playing masterfully, much to everyone's surprise, including his own. He kept playing, performing so well that he moved his buddy to tears and continuing to play for a full 6 hours, almost non-stop. He was actually inspired afterward by none other than Tony Sicoria and realized that the same thing had happened to him.